There goes Davis.
Oh, my gosh.
Davis is going to run it all the way
here
back.
Here comes pressure. Bortles sees it coming. Looking for Wharton in the end zone. Wharton behind the defense. Oh!
Are you kidding?
For the Arkansas Razorbacks, en route to a 3-9 record. But spring is a time for growth, and the 2014 Hogs hope they get better in spring practice and will have more celebration this fall. From Donald W. Reynolds Razorback Stadium in Fayetteville, Arkansas, CST is proud to bring you Arkansas football. Today, it's the first look at the 2014 Razorback football team as they hit the field for the annual red-white spring football game. We welcome you inside our broadcast booth, and we're glad that you're with us. I'm Scott Inman, along with Razorback great Quinn Grovey. Looking forward to getting a look at these Hogs in their 15th and final spring football practice. Well, Brett Bielema, Quinn, told me earlier this week, as he heads into his second year, the biggest difference between year one and year two is that he knows his players better. And that may seem like a very simple thing, but it means a lot.
It means a lot. When you talk about understanding the players and understanding the coaches, you got a great opportunity to get more familiar with the people, and they can understand what you need from a system standpoint. These guys have picked up on what coach is selling, they believe in what coach is selling, and they're ready to have a great spring game.
Well, and one thing too, Quinn, on the offensive side of the football, tremendous consistency. All of the coaching staff is back. On the defensive side of the football, there's been tremendous turnover, though. Three new coaches, including a new coordinator. What does that change look like to you?
Well, you got a lot of players on defense that really got to understand what's going on. They're trying to communicate with one another, so there's going to be some consistency that they got to really try to get together. This is a defense that's going to want to be attacking defense. But when you have three new coaches, boy, you really got to get real comfortable with one another. And that's really the big thing that they got to try to figure out today.
It is the ones versus the world. So what does that format look like? We'll talk about that and get this thing underway when we continue from Donald W. Reynolds, Razorback Stadium. Stay with us. The red-white game is coming up in minutes.
Spring day in the Ozarks as we get set to start the red-white game. But first, let's go downstairs to the third member of our broadcast team. Mike Neighbors is on the sidelines. Mike.
Thanks a lot, guys. You know, spring games are fun, and one of the great things about spring games, well, you don't have to follow the rules. You can create your own rules. Well, Brett Bielema has done just that. His format, ones against the world, which means the first teamers, the ones against everybody else. The ones will be in the red uniforms. The white team will be everybody else, and they'll rotate even though they'll share the same sidelines. Now, all the coaches will abandon the press box. It will be one big, happy Hog family on the sidelines, all the coaches, all the players. After each score, we're also flexible. Coach Bielema will decide the ball placement between the 25 and the 50-yard line to account for different situations. Special teams, they're not immune from the changes either. There'll be a kicking contest at the end of the first and third quarter, and the second half, we will shift to a running clock. Lots of changes, should be a lot of fun. We're ready to go here in the red and white game. Back to you guys.
All right, Mike, thanks very much. And there have been some spirited practices this spring on the Razorback team, and spirited competition of sorts between two brothers, a sibling rivalry, although, Quinn, the starting job is settled science going into the fall.
Absolutely. It's Brandon Allen, no doubt about it. He's a guy that's going to be the leader, and the junior is really taking on that leadership role. He's taking a more vocal role with the team. He's being more active. He's getting on receivers whenever they're not running their correct routes. So it's a great job for Brandon. He really wants to get that bad taste out of his mouth, and I'm anxious to see how he does.
All right, so take a look at the starters for the red team. Again, these are the ones. Dan Skipper, Mitch Smothers, Luke Charpentier, and Denver Kirkland, along with Bray Cook, the big guys up front. And there has been a lot of competition and a lot of switching back and forth on the positions on the offensive line. We might even see Mitch Smothers at center today. A.J. Derby, you may recognize that name. He was the backup quarterback in 2013, but in spring camp, was switched to tight end and has seemed to be a very natural fit at that position. How about in the backfield? Well, we talked about Brandon Allen calling the signals. Jonathan Williams, Cody Walker kind of filling that Kiero Small role at fullback. Demetrius Wilson, Keon Hatcher at the wideouts, but we'll also see some new guys, and we'll talk about them as we go along. And Alex Collins, of course, will be right behind Jonathan Williams in getting some snaps. There is Keon Hatcher, one of the returners at wide receiver for this red team. They'll start their first possession of the game at their own 25-yard line. And Brandon Allen, all of the quarterbacks wearing the green jerseys today. That means no contact, so we'll do our best to tell you who is actually under center. Brandon will be calling the signals for the red, and on the white squad, it's Austin Alley. Allen, and we'll also see Rafe Peavy. First game, first snap of the red-white game, and it's Jonathan Williams looking for room on the right side, and he gets about a four-yard gain.
Jonathan Williams has been with 5 yards.
Otha Peters on the stop for the white team. Did you look at Brandon Allen's stats, Quinn, from last year?
Brandon Allen had a decent year. You know, he would want to get that bad taste out of his mouth. He only went for 1,500 yards and only had a 49% completion percent. So he wants to definitely get that well into the 60s.
Allen will go from the shotgun on a second down and 5 play. He looks left, and the ball batted into the air, and it might have been picked off by the white squad. It is. Interception by DeAndre Coley. And on the second play for the red offense, the white team gets a turnover.
Well, that's definitely something that Brandon does not want to start his spring game doing. He had 13 interceptions last year. He dropped back in the pocket, looking for his receiver. The defensive back did a great job of breaking on the ball, really slapping the ball down, and then making a great catch.
Well, that's got to be a big confidence boost for the white team, which is, in other terminology, the world, which is everybody but the number ones. But there are some talented players for sure on that white roster. Austin Allen getting the start for the white team at quarterback. And he'll hand off right away. And that is not Corliss Marshall getting the start. Marshall was expected to be the number one running back. That might have been Denzel Evans. It was a 6-foot redshirt freshman from Houston. Here's the offensive line for the white squad. Beck, Deacon, Boyd, Dan Hauer, Allison, and Hunter Henry, the tight end. Alex Collins possibly playing for the white, although I think he's dressed out with the red. And now Allen on the play fake. On second down, throws it complete at the 25-yard line to Damon Mitchell, and that's Duop Mitchell, the one-time quarterback, who has swapped positions and gone to wide receivers this fall as you look at the defensive lineup for the red. Flowers will not be playing today. He's held out of the scrimmage. Mitchell, Spaten, Ellison, that's your number one linebacking core heading into the fall. We'll see how they do. Carroll Washington said to make great strides in the defensive secondary this spring, and Allen Turner at safety. You saw the rest of the defensive backfield. It's third down and about a yard at the Reds' 25-yard line, and that's Evans again rolling over the right side, and he'll have a first down for the white.
Well, you know, Scott, this is really not a situation that you want your defense to be in, but it's a great time to really practice that situation. Brandon threw an interception on the first series. You bring your defense out, put it in a short field, so now they've really got to deal with this situation. You know, Coach Rob Smith really talked about wanting to play great situational football. Now he's in a situation where his team is really going to have to react.
Evans again in the backfield. Behind Patrick Ahrens is the fullback out of the I formation on first down and 10. Big hole for Evans, and he's inside the 20-yard line. That white offensive line doing a good job against the number one defensive line.
Give a lot of credit to that offensive line. That offensive line is getting physical, and they've been physical all spring long. They've done a great job opening up big gaping holes, and then the linebackers on defense had to really come clean that play up.
And Arkansas very talented up front on the defensive line again this year, even though they lost a lot, Quinn. I mean, you're talking about Robert Thomas and Byron Jones and Chris Smith going to the NFL, and you see some of that talent on the defensive side of the ball there. It was not from the front, but it was from the free safety position. Allen Turner with the big hit. It'll be third down and long, but you feel pretty good about the defensive line when you insert guys like Darius Filon into the lineup and DeMarcus Hodge, and Brandon Lewis showed glimpses of being a good defensive end as well, and of course Trey Flowers, who's not playing today.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that you really want in the SEC. You want to be able to have and be able to rotate two defensive linemen to be defensive line fronts to be able to go in there and go against those SEC offensive lines.
They don't get much of a pass rush though on third and long, and Austin Allen sits in the pocket and completes it to his running back Denzel Evans. He'll be close to a first down, but I think he will be a yard short.
Well, and a lot of people might look at that and say, boy, you're in the red zone territory and you check it down. The one thing that I like to see from a quarterback is being able to check it down to your running back and give them the opportunity. Now you've got a situation where you got a chance to get 3 points. You didn't turn the football over, and that's what you want to stay away from in the red zone.
Lane Sowling will set up and try a 32-yard field goal to get the white team on the board first. And he does. So a little bit of a surprise here. You expect a rout by the red, but the white team strikes first thanks to an interception on the second play from scrimmage. We're back in Fayetteville in just a moment. First pitch is set for 7, 6 Central. For the full broadcast schedule, log on to CoxSportsTV.com. Red set to go in their second series. Their first one ended on their second play with an interception from Brandon Allen. Alex Collins now in the backfield for the first time today as the Red starts from their own 25-yard line. Allen's going to throw, though, and he's got Keon Hatcher, but he is met immediately and dropped by DJ Dean off the corner. And he was in perfect position to make the play.
Yeah, Scott, you really like that play call. When you come back from throwing an interception, what you really want to do is, if you're Jim Chaney, is get Brandon Allen some confidence. He threw a little short hitch route to Keon Hatcher and trying to get him back on track.
Second and 5 from the red 30-yard line. And it's Collins. And Collins met in the backfield by 2 Razorbacks. T.Q. Coleman, the first to drop him. You think they knew that play call, Quinn?
Absolutely. T.Q. Coleman has done a great job. He's been kind of a converted safety linebacker kind of guy, hybrid guy, but he's a guy who runs in there relentless with his hair on fire. And that's a big deal for him because Alex Collins last year very rarely had lost yardage plays.
You know, the defense has to recognize offensive formations.
Absolutely.
They also recognize anytime Alex Collins is in the ball game, and they made a great play there. It is Mitch Smothers, by the way, snapping the football at center. Time to throw for Allen, but he has no one to throw to. A little shovel pass to Alex Collins. He breaks out of a tackle. Look out. Can't turn the corner, though. Good pursuit by the Razorback white defense. Taiwan Johnson wrestles him down in the backfield.
You'll hear me continue to refer to the check down. I love the fact that he checked down. Now, he did an unconventional little Johnny football check down just then. Alex Collins caught the football and then really tried to make something out of nothing. I mean, he's a guy that has the ability to make big, long runs, and he tried to get one and try to get a first down in that particular situation.
So the red team will have to punt. 2 unsuccessful series for them. This will probably be whistled dead. They'll call a fair catch at the 32-yard line. T.Q. Coleman returning the punts. And that's one of the things I'm looking forward to seeing, too, is who develops, Quinn, into a return guy. You lose Javonte Herndon, yeah, who didn't really return much, but he was your guy back there. You have Corliss Marshall as a possibility, maybe Keon Hatcher. That time is T.Q. Coleman.
Well, with Javonte Herndon, what you had is a guy who was going to catch the football. You knew he was going to catch the football. He did a lot of fair catching. But what I would really want to get back to is somebody who absolutely scares you to death. You know, when Joe Adams was back there, that was like another offensive play. And the defense has really had the game plan for that. So looking for somebody to catch the football, secure it, and then absolutely make big plays.
Well, those numbers got me again. That wasn't Coleman. It was the other number 7 on the white. That was Damon Mitchell, who actually returned or caught the ball in punt return formation. Short run by Evans. Brooks Ellis makes the stop for the red team. And Evans has been the ball carrier the whole way so far for the white squad.
Well, you know, Coach Rob Smith is really going to run a 4-3 defense, and he's going to run some quarter-quarter halves behind that, really giving those defensive backs an opportunity. But this defense wants to play physical, and they want to play with passion, and that's really what he's trying to instill.
Austin Allen, again, the quarterback on 2nd down and 9, play fake and a rollout. Pump fake, and now he's going to run. There'll be no contact there. They'll whistle him dead at the 36-yard line. So a minimal pickup. Braylon Mitchell gets credit for the tackle.
Well, that's a play that you're going to see an awful lot. When you have a running game like Arkansas, you're going to be able to see a lot of play action, a lot of boots and waggles off of that. That gives you an opportunity to move the pocket. It also gives you an opportunity to get your quarterback out on the corner so he can see what's going on and get out of that trash.
Coach Bielema told me earlier this week that the position he's most concerned about is backup quarterback. Brandon Allen, a solid number one heading into the fall. His brother Austin, as you can see now, is the number two, but barely. Rafe Peavy is right there, and there'll be a good competition in the fall to see who gets the backup quarterback role. Long drop, and Allen throws a short pass complete to Scotty Thurman, the other Scotty Thurman. And it's a little bit of a loss. Maybe he got back to a no-gain situation.
Well, you see Brandon Allen, he caught the ball. Austin Allen caught the football and really had great protection. You got to give that offensive line a lot of protection. That was a long developing route, and he actually got it out to his receiver.
Toby Baker on to punt it away for the white team. Well, that's a booming, spiraling kick, angling to the sidelines, though, so that'll eat up some of the would-be yardage. Jared Cornelius was actually the man in punt return formation. We won't see any of those returns today, but it gives us a chance with the timeout to talk a little bit about Jared Cornelius and some of the other new wideouts, Quinn. They're looking for a playmaker. They're looking for a deep play threat. That's something they didn't have last year. They're hoping some of the returning players can do that, but I know they're really excited about Cornelius, the freshman from Shreveport, his speed and his pass-catching ability.
He's a guy that looked really good in spring practice. He's a guy that hopefully can take the top off the defense. That's what you really need, is somebody who can really scare the defense, make them play too deep coverage. Then that'll take another man out of the box for Alex and Jonathan.
Corliss Marshall now is into the ballgame as the tailback. Another exciting player that can really do some things, and he hits a big hole. Can't get through the second layer of the defense, though. He'll be brought down after about a five-yard gain. Tywan Johnson, one of the first guys to him for the White.
And Corliss Marshall, boy, he is a special, special athlete. When he hit the scene last year, everybody was extremely excited about the speed and the ferocity that he ran with. Last year, he ran a lot of toss sweeps. This year, they're trying to really get him in between the tackles and really give him the whole playbook when it comes to the running game.
He was held out of much of spring practice because of a medical condition, but he's been back for a week or so now, a couple of weeks probably, and has looked very good. His speed may be even improving, coaches say. Another big hole for Marshall. And he breaks. One tackle, can't get through the last guy. So the tackle is made by DJ Dean. If Dean doesn't get him, Corliss Marshall was going to the end zone. There is a penalty marker down just shy of midfield.
Well, there's no doubt that that guy can get to the house and get to the house pretty quick. Just think about it. We've got probably the best three running backs
in the
SEC.
Personal foul, face mask. Two, defense, 15 yards.
When you talk about having the best three running backs in the SEC, boy, that gives you an opportunity. So just think about when we get into the season, you've got a great opportunity to have Alex and Jonathan really tire defenses down. And then you bring Corliss Marshall in, fresh legs. Boy, you got an opportunity to really hit a big run. But I really love what they're doing from a running back standpoint.
Marshall, of course, used limitedly last year, but he averaged 8.6 yards per carry. A very high number, and it may even be higher this year. And I expect his carries to go up. A play fake now for Allen. He's looking deep towards the end zone. That's Derby, and Derby can't bring it in. Had a little bit of separation, but that was pretty good coverage, Quinn.
Great coverage on a big 6'5" guy with a big frame. I mean, to be able to be in the right position, and that's what Coach Clay Jennings has really talked about, being in the right position, and then when you get there, make the right play. But then that play actually came off the play-action pass. Brandon Rowe to his left, and gave big A.J. Derby a great opportunity to go up and make a catch. That's what you want to do. A.J.'s made those catches in the spring, and, boy, he really tried to go up and do a one-hand catch that time as well.
Davion McKinney on the coverage, maybe even gotten away with a little bit of interference on that. Second down and 10 from the White 33-yard line. Out of the gun, and it'll be a draw play with Marshall. Marshall gets positive yardage after being hit almost immediately by Jamichael Winston.
That's the old smoke draw right there. You really try to get Corliss an opportunity to really pop. Jamichael Winston really held his ground, stood there and made the play. And that's what you got to do. When you talk about a defensive front, you want to be able to make plays on the other side of the backfield. Penetration is really what they're talking about, and that's what he did.
Third down and 7 from just shy of the White 30-yard line. Red looking for their first points of this spring game. Again, good time for Allen, but now he's flushed. And now he's going to have to run, and he will get the first down. He got all the way to the 20. He only needed the 23. So the red team will continue the drive. Matt Dotson ran Brandon Allen out of bounds.
As a former quarterback, I know that's the old green jersey juke. You know they can't hit you, so you're going to go ahead and slip on over there and get you a first down. And I'm not mad at you, Brandon.
You got to take advantage anywhere you can. Well, that offensive line so far, Quinn, looking pretty good on pass protection. And they did a very good job of that a year ago. Jonathan Williams gets the carry. And Jonathan Williams dragging a tackler inside the five. And he is pushed out of bounds at the 3-yard line by DJ Dean. A good run from Jay Will.
And that's what Jonathan can do. He's a big physical guy. He put on about 15 pounds in the offseason. And Coach Herbert said he's one of the guys who's really done a great job of just working out in the weight room. And you can really see him getting physical. He runs with great patience. He's got the ability to see the hole and then explode through it. And then put that stiff arm on him trying to get to the end zone.
But when you think about what's coming up in the 2014 schedule and the kinds of offenses that Arkansas is going to be up against, this is the kind of drive we want to see a lot of this year. A long ball control, time-consuming drive that's taken us close to a minute to go, and Jonathan Williams puts his nose down and crosses the goal line for a red touchdown. Running behind Cook and Charpentier and Smothers.
Well, it's really great to see that offensive line take control when you get inside the red zone. This is one of the most critical areas for Arkansas, is to be able to score when we get in the red zone. Several times last year, we had penalties or we had interceptions or fumbles in the red zone. You've got to be able to score touchdowns when you get in the red zone and not come up short and have to kick a bunch of field goals.
John Henson on for the point after, and he nails it. So a bit of a slow start by the Red, but they hit pay dirt late in this first quarter. We're back to Fayetteville in just a moment. Know it? And Cox Sports Television gets you ready for three live Saints preseason games again this year. Don't miss the black and gold on the gridiron against the Rams in week one, the Titans in week two, and the Ravens on August 28th. Stay logged on to CoxSportsTV.com for updates on game dates and times. So the white squad goes back to work, trailing now for the first time in the game from their own 25-yard line. The handoff goes to Denzel Evans. Evans getting the workload today for the white squad. Corliss Marshall was actually listed on the roster as a white squad player, but he has come out today as a red squad player. So the three big guns in the Razorback arsenal, including Jonathan Williams, all on the red squad today. So it'll be a lot of work for Denzel Evans. And he's still in there here on second down and 8 from the 27. Allen on a play fake. He's got time, zips it out complete at the 39-yard line to Damon Mitchell. And Mitchell has a first down for the White.
That's one of the toughest throws that you have to make in a college game, is to be able to throw that big, long outcut. And then you look at the quarterback, he really went with the play-action fake, stood in the pocket, and then really delivered the ball on time. And then Damon Mitchell just really did a great job of really using his body, coming back to the sideline and making the catch.
First down and 10 from the 38-yard line for Austin Allen, leading the white squad. A handoff to the backfield again. And minimal yardage going into that defensive line. Filon and Hodge. Pretty sound play for the Red.
We talked about that defensive line, and that's really got to be the strong suit for the Arkansas defense. When you talk about winning SEC games, you got to build from the inside out, and that's what Coach Bielema is really trying to do with that defensive front. Those guys are really strong and physical. We just want to make sure we continue to get guys to come in and build that two-man rotation. This defense has done a great job, and last year they were one of the top teams from a tackle from a loss standpoint.
Number 91 there, Darius Filon, actually the leading returning tackler among defensive linemen. He had more than Chris Smith. He had more than Trey Flowers. 46 stops for Filon, and he gets one in the first quarter here in the red-white game. Quarter number two coming your way from Fayetteville with the Red on top of the White, 7-3. Tonight, live from the Louisiana Cat Studio, co-host Victor Howell and Paul Crane break down the games of the week with highlights and analysis, and don't miss features from our reporters that you can't get anywhere else. CST Tonight, only on Cox Sports Television, your leader and Gulf South Sports. Well, as promised, between the first and second quarters, the kicking teams are out in a little bit of a field goal competition. And that's one of the spots, too, when you talk about, Quinn, the big losses from last year. They may not be any bigger than Zach Hocker. And the Razorbacks have a freshman coming in that's probably going to compete and probably even take that job in the name of Cole Headland from Argyle, Texas. So the guys out here kicking now, while they'll have a shot in fall, they're counting on that freshman because they gave him a scholarship. And Zach Hocker is a big hole to fill.
They've got big, big shoes to fill. When you look at Zach Hocker, he is a guy that was consistent. You talk about 354 points over his Razorback career, 77% field goal kicking percentage. So he's a guy that you could always count on. And he was a weapon. I mean, when you got across that 50-yard line, you had to really start thinking about things differently, play calling and how you handled the football, because you knew that you were going to be able to have 3 points on the board with Zach Hocker on your sideline.
So they did actually attach the points to the red team of the ones that the red team kicker made. So our score now at the end of the first quarter is 13-12. The red team with a one-point lead over the white. So two field goals went through for the red, and three went through for the white. And the white team will have the ball to start things off. It's second down and 8 from the 40-yard line. Evans is in there. And Rafe Peavy is your quarterback, and he hits a perfect strike over the middle to Drew Morgan for a white team first down.
And that's what you like to see from your quarterback, being able to see the pressure come off the right side, be able to visualize that, go 1, 2, 3, hit that back foot, and then be able to find your receiver on the slant. That's a great job by Drew Morgan, really getting inside leverage and being able to make that catch with his hands.
It's a 12-yard gain. And what about Drew Morgan, a sophomore from Greenwood? You know, he's a wants to do well as much as any Razorback out there. Has he got a chance to compete for some playing time?
He's definitely a guy, Morgan, has got the ability. He's got great hands. He's got great football IQ. And he's a guy that I know that Brandon really feels comfortable with. So I think he'll have an opportunity to definitely make a contribution.
All right, so the first throw from Rafe Peavy was a successful one. He hands off here on first down. Martrell Spate and Allen Turner making the stop for the red team. Rafe Peavy, of course, a lot of fans wanting to get a look at him. Quinn, the freshman from Missouri, 6'2", 200 pounds, a highly touted, highly recruited, highly sought-after player. They're expecting big things from him. Second down and 10, and he's going to throw. Nice ball out to Morgan again, and Morgan is rolled out of bounds after about an 8-yard pickup by Braylon Mitchell, or was it Allen Turner? Both guys in there.
Again, you can tell that Peavy feels really comfortable with the three-step game. Morgan did a great job of really stemming the defensive back and then really getting to the outside, giving Peavy just a big area to throw the football. He caught the football, turned his shoulders, and really tried to get as many yards as he could to get to that first down marker.
Brings up a third and short, third down and 3. Challenge for the white team. Peavy will step under center. Evans behind Aarons. They play fake it to Evans, and Peavy will be sacked. Really just touched, but it'll go as a sack. No contact. Dietrich Wise gets his big paw on Rafe Peavy, and that'll force a punt for the white team.
Well, that's what you talk about. You're looking for that guy who can play opposite of Trey Flowers. The Arkansas Razorbacks had 28 sacks last year, so they were one of the pressure teams in the SEC. And, boy, if you can get somebody to come off that other side with Trey Flowers, you got an opportunity to really scare quarterbacks in the SEC.
DJ Dean is back deep in punt return formation, as the white squad will kick to a white squad player. We'll see some more of that as the second half goes on. A lot of hang time on that punt, and the fair catch inside the 15-yard line where the red team will take over. A 13-12 edge for the red thanks to those field goals between quarters. We're back with more from Fayetteville after this. Apparently the white team had one more field goal than we thought at the end of the first quarter. They've now got a 15-13 lead. You got to love red-white games. Let's go down to the sidelines and Mike Nabors. Mike?
Yeah, you got to love it because you see a lot of familiar faces from the past few seasons. Here's a guy who's the team's all-time leading scorer, Zach Cocker. We just saw some kicking out there. You're an alum now. You feeling older watching the young guys out there?
Absolutely. Just a has-been now, but it's good to get out here and see our guys, especially after last season. You know, the fans and team as well. We're just kind of disappointed in our outcome, but it's good to see our guys out here working today and beautiful weather and, you know, hoping for better things next season.
Zach, you had a big year a year ago, but, you know, there's a competition now left at kicker. How do you see that competition heading into the fall now?
It's going to be great. John Henson was one of our guys last year, and he's absolutely killing the ball right now. So we also have Cole Hedlund coming in from Texas, and he's a scholarship guy, set several national records, and the competition is going to be great. They're going to be in good hands next year as far as kicking game goes.
Coach Bielma brought in the kicking format last year. I guess that was something you enjoyed, kind of the game within a game for you guys.
Oh, absolutely. Coach Bielma is really, really good at understanding the kicking game and knowing that during a spring game, there's not going to be a lot of kicks. So in between each quarter, he does a deal to where you have a small competition, and it puts points on the board as well. So it's fun.
All right, you're looking ahead to an NFL career. You've had a ton of interviews. You've been through this process. You heard what it was like, but what's it been like for you?
It's been pretty hectic, you know, and now that it's creeping up on us, you know, anxiety's kicking in, and you just want to know what's going to happen. And, you know, I don't know. It's been encouraging interviewing with teams and working out with teams. And, you know, 2 weeks from now, we'll find out and see what's going on. But as of now, I'm just enjoying this time off with my friends and family and watching some football.
You know, when you look at the process, you have all the tryouts. And it's this year because the draft's later. Do you get used to the pressure of these tryouts after you've had a few?
Yeah, you know, you just take it one day at a time. You know, the East-West Shrine Game, Pro Day, Combine, you treat it all the exact same way. And, you know, you just keep your head down and if you put up good numbers, good things will happen. So that's what I've been working on doing, and just hoping for the best.
Last thing I have, Coach Bielma, we talked to him this week, and he said being here, the experience is night and day compared to a year ago. What kind of faith do you have that he can turn things around here in Arkansas?
He's absolutely going to get this thing going. Coach is an awesome player. Love him. Like I were last year, but it was enjoyable. Of the team and the guys and having a personality that the kids can click with really well, and I have no and that these
all right, well, you know firsthand, I appreciate you taking the time. Enjoy your teammates. We're going to catch up with some of these guys later, and good luck in the draft.
All right, thank you. I appreciate it.
All right, Zach Cocker, the all-time leading scorer here in Arkansas. Guys, the draft was pushed to May. These guys wish it was yesterday. Back up to you.
All right, Mike, nice job with that interview. And boy, Zach Cocker, a guy Quinn I fully expect to be kicking on Sundays.
Zach Cocker is a great kicker. Like I said, he is money. And as a quarterback, that can be your best friend when you know you're going to be able to get points. He came out in pressure situations and delivered results. And he's one of the best kickers that we've ever had.
Hey, and for all of you fans watching and all you soccer players watching, that's how Zach Cocker got his start. He played soccer, and he ends up with a chance to kick for lots of money in the NFL. Holds about every kicking record now at the University of Arkansas. Meantime, there was a brief injury timeout. Tywan Johnson was shaken up. He was taken off the field. Looked like he might be okay. What a booming kick this was. And TQ Coleman can't handle it. He fumbles it back towards the end zone. I don't know what they're going to call this. I mean, it's your guess is as good as mine is what we're going to call. Okay. I think it's still going to be the white ball. They can't cough. They can't muff a punt in the red-white game, apparently.
Wow, that's one of those things where you really got to make sure you secure that punt. And that's what we had with Javonte Herndon last year. There's no doubt about it. And we've got to find somebody that can do that this year as well.
Well, the distance on that punt, I think, really wow. Took. And I called him Coleman again. The other number seven, Damon Mitchell on the return. I think the distance, it just went over his shoulder. He misjudged the distance on it.
He misjudged it, and then he thought, well, should I go get
exactly.
it? Are we live, or what should we
exactly.
do here? And then he touched it, and then he's like, oh, my gosh, I'm in the end zone. So that's just kind of a bad situation. They'll probably use that as definitely a coaching opportunity.
All right, so they will get the ball back to the white. They'll start at the 20-yard line, and it's PB back out at quarterback along with Denzel Evans in the backfield, and Duwat Mitchell is in the ballgame, too, at wideout. He's got a couple of catches today. Back to pass, Peavy under pressure, and he will be sacked again, and again it's Dietrich Wise.
Great pressure, but then you got to give that secondary a lot of credit. This secondary has played extremely well today. They've done a great job of really causing problems for the quarterback, but you can see Peavy has been 2 for 2. He's been one of the most effective quarterbacks out there throwing the football. But give a lot of credit to Clay Jennings. I mean, he's a guy that's come in, and one of the things that they've done differently with the defense is they've allowed Coach Jennings to coach the entire secondary. Usually you'll have a linebacker coach the safeties, but what that does is when you can talk to all four, it gives you an opportunity to have great communication and be on the same page.
And there's been a lot of talk this spring, too, Quinn, that we're going to play more press coverage. You're going to see more of that from the corners this fall as well. And there's a draw play that goes nowhere either. The red team defense sniffing that out.
Well, you can definitely play more press coverage when you've got guys who are consistent in what they're doing. The secondary has some experience that they can bring to the table. But I always say pressure equals picks. And coverage equals sacks. So it goes hand in hand. So when you got a great defensive front, Coach Rob Smith is a guy who's had success at all levels. He's going to disguise a lot of different things. So it's great to have him on staff.
So the white team in a big hole here, third down and 15. Peavy goes from the shotgun. And he's going to run. Nope. Now he will. And he'll be sacked again. That may actually go for no gain on a rush. Braylon Mitchell gets credit for the stop. How do you like Wise with the celebration a moment ago on that sack? I didn't think he could really celebrate that much for a tap sack. But he was celebrating like he got a big hit.
Those defensive guys are going to always celebrate because they're going to think in their mind it would have been a big hit.
That's right.
And that's how they do. And they're talking trash to you as they run by you saying that they would have really knocked your head off. So it's a situation. It's great to see them in the right position. It's great to see that pressure. And I've been impressed with what they've done from a defensive front standpoint. I've also been impressed with what they've done from a coverage standpoint. So that one defense is really looking pretty good right now.
Jared Cornelius is back deep in punt return formation now, standing at the 40-yard line. We talked about the spirited practices, too. This is a short kick. It'll be caught by Cornelius at the 49-yard line. We'll talk a little bit about how they've mixed it up a little bit in spring practice, especially up front between those offensive and defensive linemen. That's when we come back. That's on Cox Sports Television this weekend. Tonight, Tennessee faces LSU live in a 7:30, 6:30 Central game. Then on Sunday, our triple header starts with Grambling and Southern live at 2 o'clock, 1 o'clock Central, followed by replays of two SEC showdowns, Ole Miss at Kentucky and Georgia at Vanderbilt. Visit our website for the full schedule as we go back to work here with 6:02 left to go in the second quarter of this red-white game. Only two scores, even though it's a 15-13 game. One touchdown for the red and one field goal for the white in live action play. And that ball high from Brandon Allen, intended for Kendrick Payne. He couldn't bring it down. Well, we talked about, I got the chance, Quinn, earlier this week to watch practice, and I've been reading about the reports from practice, too, about how spirited, how a lot of the guys have gotten into it a little bit. Coach Bielema likes that to an extent. Doesn't want any punches thrown, but those offensive and defensive linemen were going at one another pretty good. And anytime there was any kind of a scene, Denver Kirkland was right in the middle of it.
Well, you know, I think that really makes you better. When you talk about having a big offensive front and a big defensive front, you really want to play that mano-a-mano.
Good run here by Collins as he breaks into the secondary, tripped up inside the 30-yard line, but there's a flag down, and it's probably coming back. Dante Carr brought Collins down.
But we talked about those scuffles, and there's no doubt that those offensive linemen and defensive linemen have gone back, and the offensive line won this scuffle, this particular situation.
...76 of the offense, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, second down.
Dan Skipper, one of those guys in the middle of a lot of those skirmishes in practice. That may be why the offensive line got a little.
Look at the great patience from Alex. I mean, that's what he does. He has great vision. He's got the ability to see what's going on. And he's so explosive. And when he sees the hole, he really hits it. Those are the type of runs that we need to turn into touchdowns this year. This team really needs points. When we get somebody in the open, boy, we really need Jonathan and Alex to take it to the house.
Alex Collins came up a little bit gimpy there after that run, too. Kind of maybe got his ankles tied. There's a pass floated out to Corliss Marshall, and he can't make it back to the original line of scrimmage. T.K. Coleman there to bring him down.
But you really got to like the design of that play. What you really want to do as an offensive coordinator, if you're Jim Chaney, is really find ways to get the ball to your players in space. Corliss Marshall was a playmaker, so you get him the football in space to have an opportunity to get to the house. But that's a great sure tackle by Coleman to be able to come up and make that tackle. That's what you got to be able to do.
You think maybe we'll see more of that in the fall? We didn't see the running backs catch much out of the backfield, but you do have guys who can really turn it on when they get the football. Allen, time to throw over the middle, incomplete. And that was intended for Hunter Henry, who does not have a catch so far today. What do you think about the running backs catching the football, Quinn?
Well, I think that that's a great opportunity to get them the football in space. You can do it on a lot of swing passes. You can do it on draws. You can do it on screens. And it's just like a running play, but you get them out of all the garbage and give them the opportunity to use their vision and get out there in one-on-one situations and make somebody have to tackle them.
Jim Chaney and Brandon Allen talking over what they saw on that last play. Meantime, the Red will kick it away. Well, another booming punt. Sent back to the 12-yard line, and DJ Dean pulls it in there. Well, a reminder, in the second half, the clock will run continuously. So this is the bulk of the scrimmage, really, the next 4:44. And you may see some players switch jerseys, too, at halftime. We really don't know what we're going to get in the second half, Quinn. We're going to have to be on our toes.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm going to depend on you to make sure you get everybody spotted correctly.
Yeah.
And we know who's doing what.
We're going to depend on Jeff, my spotter. That's who we're going to depend on. It'll be Rafe Peavy again at quarterback for the white team. And he works from the I formation. And the handoff goes to Connor McPherson for his first carry of the game, and he barely gets back to the line of scrimmage.
Great play by that defensive line. Again, I know we've talked about it continuously, but when your defensive line is doing a great job of getting penetration and disrupting the timing in the running game, that gives you an opportunity to be successful. That defensive front has got to eat up a lot of space and eat up blockers on that offensive line so those linebackers can run free and make plays. The one thing we don't want to do is be in a situation where Allen Turner is the leading tackler again.
McPherson again in the backfield, a freshman from the Woodlands, Texas. Peavy on a rollout. He is a mobile guy, and he will get the pass away. That was almost up. They will call a sack. I think they did whistle that dead. Way back at the 5-yard line. Well, the white team has thrown the ball around pretty well between Austin Allen and Rafe Peavy. They've gotten it to Duop Mitchell, Drew Morgan. Evans has one. Scotty Thurman one.
And Damon and Drew have looked really good running routes. Damon has really converted to wide receiver pretty good. He looks like a natural, and he looks like he has some playmaking ability.
So it's third down and a mile here. We'll call it 18. Peavy's got his feet on the end zone line. And it'll be punt time. There wasn't much happening there. He tried to dump it off to McPherson, but he felt the pressure there.
That was great read and reaction by Darius Fyline. He's a guy who really sniffed that screen out. He's a playmaker. He's got the ability to sack you. I mean, he's got great football awareness. He saw the screen and just redirected, went out there. But then also Brooks was coming to clean it up as well. And that's what you like to see from your linebacking core and your defense, when you can play that football read and reaction and be able to be lined up and make the play.
Now, Coach Bielema has come out onto the field. He'll stand in the end zone to watch this punt play here. A wobbly kick this time that takes a bound inside the 45. Will roll across midfield. Again, it was Cornelius back there setting up as a punt returner, stopping the clock down at 3:03. The New Orleans Zephyrs return to Cox Sports Television with four games this season. Don't miss a pitch as we begin our coverage on Friday, June 6th. Round Rock comes to Zephyr Field. Join us for two matchups in July and then again on August 1st. All games are live at 8, 7 Central. Visit our website for full minor league baseball schedules on CST, your leader in Gulf South sports. Well, it is a gorgeous day here on this final Saturday in April, and the Razorbacks completing spring practice with this red-white game. So this is the last look for fans at the team until August. Brandon Allen hands off to Corliss Mitchell. Behind his blocker, gets into the secondary, and see ya! Corliss Mitchell with breakaway speed. Touchdown, Red! By Corliss Marshall.
Anytime you're going to have a long run, you're going to get great blocking downfield. And you can look and see that the pulling guard, Luke Charpentier, doing a great job of getting that seal. And then when you give Corliss Marshall a space like that, he can really fly through it. He's a home run hitter. He's a touchdown maker. And he's a guy that's very explosive.
Electric play finally here in the red-white game, and Henson puts through the extra point. The Red takes the lead back at 20-15 as you take another look at the Marshall run.
Great job of really reading, reacting, and then slipping behind the block, and then just getting through the hole and just showing the burst of speed that he has. He knew when he saw that clear sailing, he was not going to get caught.
Had a talk with the running back core earlier this week, and I asked him several questions. Corliss Marshall, by the way, 4 carries, 87 yards with that big chunk of real estate there. I asked him a lot of questions about which guy out of the 3 or 4 guys in the running back stable had, like, the best ability to break tackles or the best vision. Corliss said, I don't really have any vision. He has touchdown vision. That's what he's got, Quinn.
That's right. He's going to be a guy that's going to be a high yard per carry average guy. He's a guy that's going to get a lot of long runs and really cause some problems in the SEC.
He deferred to Alex Collins, and here's a pick for the Red team, and that will be taken back to the house. Rohan Gaines stepped in front of the pass and was untouched into the end zone. The Reds starting to take over here.
And that's one of the things that you really wanted to see from the number one defense, being able to get some takeaways. Only had 14 takeaways last year, so it's great to see the defender really stepping in the games, really being in the right position, catching the football, and then turning an interception into points. That's what you got to be able to do. Sometimes you're not going to always be able to score offensively, so anytime you can get a touchdown from your defense, boy, that really gives you an opportunity, especially when you talk about 2 minutes and 48 seconds before the half. Great situational football.
Eric Hawkins was the intended receiver. Austin Allen was actually the quarterback back in on that play. It's a slight difference since they all wear the green mesh jerseys there. It's kind of hard to tell whether it's Austin Allen or Rafe Peavy, but we can tell you that Austin has a long white undershirt almost down to his elbows, and Peavy has just a little bit of white shirt peeking through. And Austin Allen was the quarterback back in on that play, and he'll be back out for this next series. So 2 quick touchdowns by the Red, and they're starting to assert the ones versus the world that we kind of expected.
Yeah, and this is going to be a great opportunity for Austin to really come out and redeem himself. This is a tough situation for a guy that's really getting his first action. I mean, he just threw an interception. It's 2 minutes and 48 seconds before the half, and as a quarterback, from a situational standpoint, you really got to understand what that can do to your team. So I'm really anxious to see how he responds if he gets an opportunity to go into this 2-minute offense. Will he come out slinging, or will he be tentative?
Denzel Evans is back in now as the running back, redshirt freshman from Houston, standing beside Austin Allen on 1st and 10. Allen with time, and he's hit from behind. The ball is loose. That's going to be a fumble. Darius Filon picks it up, and he's going to return it for another defensive touchdown. Back-to-back defensive touchdowns for the Red team.
Well, one of the things that Coach Smith really wanted his team to do is play with passion and be a lot more physical. And this defensive front is really starting to assert his will. You know, he stepped up into the pocket, really had an opportunity to swipe the football. But the one thing you like to see about the defense is that they're turning turnovers into points. And that's a really great thing. Now, offensively, you know, Jim Chaney is probably going crazy over there, you know, wondering what's going on. When we try to put it in a situation for the quarterback to lead us down the field, we turn it over 2 times. That's something that they'll have to work on.
And give Dietrich Wise credit for stripping the ball free, and Filon with a lot of speed taking it to the house. And the Red with a big lead over the White here late in the second quarter.
Well, you can see we talked about the pressure all day long. That front has done a great job. And when you talk about pressure, you got to give credit to that secondary as well. This defensive front is doing a great job. And Trey Flowers isn't even on the field. So, you know, it's great to see that type of pressure and aggressiveness playing behind the line of scrimmage, being in the right position. And that's one thing that I really like to see, a lot of great alignment assignment football. Everybody's reading their keys and playing with the passion.
Well, it took about a quarter and a half, Quinn. We saw the white team come out with an advantage early with the field goal. The Reds slow to get started on offense, but the defense has taken over here, and another big pop as that ball was laid out intended for Jeremy Sprinkle. But he really never had a chance. Carroll Washington laying the lick along with Alan Turner.
Yeah, that's one of those balls, Scott, that the receivers call a medicine ball. When you throw those balls out there and that cornerback is sitting in roll coverage waiting on it, after you catch that football, you may need some medicine. So he's definitely got to make sure that we understand the coverage and don't throw in the roll coverage.
Correction, it wasn't Turner, it was Spate along with Washington on that hit. Second down and 10, and there's Wise again breaking free. And he'll get another sack. Four sacks now, credited to Dietrich Wise.
And he's doing a great job. You can tell going up against Dan Skipper and Denver Kirkland every single day is really helping him out today.
Watch him coming off the left again here on third down and a mile again. They're going to whistle that play dead, too. Didn't really look like that was going to be a sack, but they'll stop it. Brandon Lewis, I guess, the closest guy. It's about the easiest sack he'll ever get in his career.
And it's good to see him come on as well. You know, I'm just really impressed with what they're doing. And Coach Egress has done a great job of instilling his philosophy. He's had a lot to work with. You know, Dietrich Wise is a guy that is just making a lot of plays as well. And just, you know, give that team a lot of credit. Coach is coaching him up right now, saying, take it easy a little bit, fella.
Wise, a sophomore from Carrollton, Texas. Phylon, a sophomore. Two guys that will be instrumental in the Razorbacks' chances in 2014. Another fair catch by DJ Dean. Well, Coach Bielema, we asked him what he wanted to see to consider the red-white game a success today. And the number one thing, and I think every coach is going to say this, Quinn, and that's stay healthy.
Yeah, and that's a big one. And we saw Tywan Johnson go down just earlier in the game, and you really want to stay healthy with that particular aspect of it. You want to put on a great show, but you don't want to come out here with any injuries that's going to set you back when you go into summer workouts.
And what about throwing the football? That's been a little bit spotty at best so far.
Yeah,
today.
I think we've struggled with that particular aspect of it. Coach Chaney, I'm sure, wants more production out of this passing game. He's had some good protection, but the coverage has been pretty good, and we just hadn't really got through our progressions.
Still plenty of time for Brandon Allen to work with at midfield. He throws the quick hit on a slant, complete to Keon Hatcher, and that's a 7 to 8 yard gain. Actually, they're going to give him inside the 45-yard line and move the sticks. Hatcher with a dive for the sticks, and it's a first down for the Red. Allen looking over the middle into heavy traffic. It's batted up and picked off again. His second interception of the day. That time, Davion McKinney. And that was an easy pick for McKinney. It was the coverage that created it. McKinney just playing center field.
Great coverage. You're exactly right with that, Scott. Great coverage. Brandon really stared down the receiver, threw it in the double coverage, and that's what you want to see from your defense. Tip drill, balls in the air, go make a catch. And then what you've done is really prevented the offense from moving the football. So as a defense, you've done exactly what you needed to do. As an offense, now you've given the white team an opportunity to put some additional points on the board, being close in the free-willing zone.
That was TQ Coleman that kind of stepped in front of the pass and batted it up into the air. And Dean was in coverage. Good job by the white secondary. They'll give their offense a chance now. They're going to blow that one dead again. Boy, there's a trend developing here, Quinn. On one side, the white secondary is playing great ball and stopping the red passing game. But on the other side of things, the defensive front for the red is not letting the quarterbacks get anything going for the white.
Well, they're doing a great job. And you've put them in some situations, in some tough situations after turnovers, to really come out on the field and try to make a difference.
All right, so a quick hit that time. Austin Allen over the middle gets it to Alex Volsky, and that gets it back inside the original line of scrimmage. And they'll be in the hurry up here as the clock ticks down to 23 and under. left to play until halftime of the red-white game. Quick hit again, and that ball is knocked away. Good coverage again by Carroll Washington. Scotty Thurman, the intended receiver.
Carroll Washington has done a great job today. He's made a couple plays. He had the roll-up corner play where he almost knocked the receiver out, and then he had a great play on this particular play, breaking on the football and disrupting the timing of that passing route.
All right, so it's fourth down, but no punt with 14 seconds left to go. Maybe see a deep ball here. We haven't seen a deep ball yet today. Allen looks right, now comes back across the field and connects with Drew Morgan, and that'll be a first down for the White. And we'll stop the clock with 7 seconds to play. Braylon Mitchell on the coverage and the stop for the Red.
Well, big play to keep the drive alive, especially on fourth down. Now it looks like you've got one more play, which would be a Hail Mary.
Allen sets up to throw. Up the sidelines, got a man, and he's got a touchdown. Eric Hawkins. A 45-yard strike from Austin Allen to Eric Collins.
Well, great job of Austin Allen standing in the pocket and fitting the ball in between the corner and the safety. You've got a window in most cases of 18 to 22 yards to keep that safety from getting over the top. Eric Hawkins did a great job of tracking the football down, making a defender miss, and getting in the end zone. How important is that at the end of the half to really end the half that way?
An efficient 2-minute drill, to say the least, for the White team. And as time expires on the first half of the 2014 red-white game, it is a 34-22 red team lead. We saw a little bit of everything. It started kind of slowly, Quint, but man, there was a lot of action in the last half of the second quarter.
It really picked up. The red defense really came out and started making some plays with that defensive front in the secondary. The white secondary has done a great job of really containing Brandon Allen and just really keeping him from having, you know, the day that he really thought he was going to have. And then you see this last play at the end of the half to really score a touchdown. Boy, you know, there's going to be some coaching going on at halftime, and, you know, they'll be able to use this film to really help him out.
Two defensive touchdowns for the red, and for the white, their only touchdown on the final play of the first half. There'll be a 15-minute halftime and then a continuous running clock in the second half. So we'll scoot through the second half. But in the meantime, Rhett Bielema is going to talk with us on the sidelines as we head down to the sidelines. And Mike Neighbors. Mike.
Thank you very much, guys. Coach Bielema joins us kind of slow early, but boy, things heated up right before the half. What stood out for you?
Well, obviously, we got to take care of the football. We had a couple turnovers. We don't want to tackle the quarterback, so those probably could have been a questionable dead ball there. But the kids are having fun. I think they're out there trying to convert. We just got to clean better up in the second half.
Talk about your running game. It was great in your first year, and Corliss Marshall, you liked him this spring. Runs for almost 100 yards on 4 carries in the first half.
You know, he's very explosive. Definitely brings another gear. Really, the combination of those three guys with Jay Will and with Alex and Corliss brings a different pace car.
Brand new defensive coordinator Rob Smith. You guys have back-to-back takeaways for scores. I know those are the kind of plays that you want to see.
They are, but not that last play right before the end of the half.
No,
we had the safety fall asleep over there at top. But I think the defensive guys during the spring have really developed and got a sense of awareness to them that I don't think we had last year, just about the ability to, you know, do the simple things, play aggressive, good tackling, smart fundamentals, and hopefully that's going to pay off.
Lastly, I know you're going to have a few changes possibly in the second half. What are we going to see in the second half?
Well, because we got to play a little bit better, I'm going to keep going with the same rotation we had. In the fourth quarter, we'll get some of our backup guys in there and let them have a little bit of fun out here, too.
I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Coach Brett Bielema here in the red and white ones against the world format. Pretty entertaining first half. We'll have much more coming up at halftime from Fayetteville, Arkansas.
The 2014 spring game. The White will start with the football at their own 30-yard line. Well, a very action-packed half of a second quarter after a slow start by both squads, but the defensive front for the red team has really stood out in the first half, and the secondary has had its moments as well. Cody Walker is the running back for the white team here to start us off in the third quarter, and a good stop by Allen Turner to limit Cody to about a 2-yard gain at best. You take a look at the numbers from the quarterbacks, the brothers Austin Allen and Brandon Allen.
Brandon really struggled in the first half. 5 of 11. He had the two picks. Brandon Allen, Austin Allen, rather, a good percentage at 7 of 10 passing. Rafe Peavy was also in the mix there as well. He was 2 of 3 for 20 yards. But the white team quarterback sacked 7 times in the first half. Dietrich Wise had 4 of them. Pass completion there from Allen. Out to Damon Mitchell. Mitchell gets his third catch of the spring game.
Scott, he's looking extremely good doing it. He loved the route that he ran. I mean, he really got to the peak of his route and really fought the defensive back off, came back and made a great catch, and then gave us a third and short.
The white team trying to put together an offensive drive here. They scored only once in the first half, and it was on the final play of the half. They will get close to first down yardage that time as Walker broke the plane, I think, of the 40-yard line. They should move the sticks.
Well, it's great to see Cody Walker, you know, in the tailback position. He's going to fill that Kiero Small role.
You see a player down, too, and that's Brandon Lewis, as we take a look at first half highlights, Quinn.
As you look at the highlights, the defense has definitely ruled the day. There's no doubt. They forced offense into several turnovers, several picks. But what you like, though, is the way the offense has really come through from the standpoint of running the football. You like what Jonathan Williams has done. You like what Corliss Marshall has done. They've really done a great job of just really hitting the hole. And when they've had opportunities to bust loose, they've done a fantastic job of doing that. But the defense has really done a fantastic job of really controlling the day. I know Coach Bielema is really wanting us to really clean up the turnovers and make sure that we have a productive second half.
There's the pick six from Rohan Gaines. But then on the other end, as Dietrich Wise on the very next play, after that pick six, he took it into the end zone. But then after that, on the final play of the half, it was Gaines, I believe, was the safety that came over late on the deep ball as the white team scored the touchdown with the long pass to Hawkins. Well, they've got Brandon Lewis off the field now, and we're back to action. First down and 10 on the 41-yard line. And it's the draw play to Cody Walker. And Walker gets over the 45. They'll give him the 47-yard line. That's going to be a pickup of 6 yards. Brought down by Dietrich Wise and Allen Turner, who've been around the football all day.
We talked about Cody as filling that Kiero Small role. He's got to be a guy that's got to play fullback, and he's going to play tailback. He's a guy that's got to be versatile, and I'm certain you're going to see him definitely in short yardage situations, maybe in some of that wild hog stuff whenever you talk about needing to get a first down with short yardage. He's a guy that can absolutely move the crowd and B.O.B., be your own blocker.
Second down and 4, and a shotgun for Austin Allen. Heavy rush. He rolls out of it, and that play will be whistled dead. DeMarcus Hodge, that time the closest guy. He'll probably get credit for the sack. Good pressure from the big guy.
And one of the things that really causes problems from a defensive line standpoint, defensive front standpoint, when you've got guys that are able to put pressure on a quarterback like that, it causes problems. But then the other problem that it causes, you're looking at guys that are 6'6 with big long wingspan. So whenever they can't get to you, they've got an opportunity to disrupt your throwing lanes because of that long wingspan with potentially knocking down footballs.
So it's 3rd and 11 for Austin Allen and the white offense. This time he gets some protection and he loops it out towards the sidelines. That ball was caught, but it was out of bounds. Mitchell with a diving catch, but he couldn't stay in bounds.
We've been in 3rd and long for a lot of situations today, and that's the situation you want to stay out of. When you're a running football team, you want to be able to stay ahead of the sticks. You want to be able to get positive yards on the first down and be able to have 2nd and 6, 3rd and 3. Those are the situations we want to be able to operate from. When you get into a 3rd and long situation, that puts a lot of pressure on your quarterback.
They are not rolling the clock right now. We were told it was going to be a continuous clock in the second half, but they did stop it there on that incompletion. Cornelius makes the catch at the 16-yard line. The Red will go back to work there when we return. The Red team with a 34-22 lead over the White. So it's Red-White game. The Pensacola Blue Wahoos return to Cox Sports Television this season. Join us for 4 live games beginning Sunday, June 1st, 5, 4 Central, when they host Jacksonville. We also bring you their June 20th matchup against Huntsville and two showdowns in July against Montgomery. All games are live from Pensacola Bayfront Stadium. Visit our website for the full minor league baseball schedule on CST, your leader in Gulf South sports. As the Red goes back to work, and Brandon Allen's first throw of the second half is incomplete. He got rid of that in a hurry, intended for Patrick Ahrens out of the backfield. Red team in the first half totaled 140 yards of offense. 119 of that was on the ground. Passing game has not been jump-started. Here's Jonathan Williams turning the corner and spinning off tacklers up to the 25-yard line. That's going to be about a yard short of a first down.
Well, Scott, when you're struggling with the passing game, boy, there's no better alternative to be able to turn and toss that ball to Jonathan Williams. He gives you a great opportunity to bail you out in a lot of situations. I know Brandon definitely wants to get his completion percent up. He was 5 of 11 in the first half with two interceptions, so when we talk about really trying to be progressing in the second half, Brandon wants to have a great second half.
Watching him practice on Tuesday this week, he still throws a nice ball. He fits some in into tight coverage in those workouts. You know the ability is there. Here's a big hole for Jonathan Williams, and Williams is going to have the first down and a lot more. He gets into white territory across the 50 and down at the 43. Brought down by Davion McKinney. That was a great play call and well executed.
Well, you got the old counter play right there, and what happened was that cornerback lost contain. Keon Hatcher got a great block on the corner. That left Jonathan Williams a clean corner and able to really try to dance and get extra yardage on Will Hines.
Williams will stay in there. Does not need a breather on first down and 10 from the 43 of the white. Out of the eye. Two wide outs, and Allen's going to throw to one of them. Right side. It is dropped by Keon Hatcher. Hatcher was turning him go upfield before he had the football.
And that's one of the things that you got to have. We got Keon Hatcher is going to be our leader this year, and he has an opportunity to be the receiving leader on this particular team. And he talked about really wanting to show leadership and show these younger guys the way. He talked about if you have drop passes with him being the leader, you got to do push-ups. He said, yeah, you're either going to drop passes or you're going to have a big chest. So he's probably going to have to do a couple push-ups on the sideline.
He didn't do it right there on the field, but he may owe Coach Bielema about 10 push-ups. Second down and 10. Allen looking it in to Hunter Henry, who makes the catch and steps out of bounds immediately at the 36-yard line. That's going to bring up third down and short. D.J. Dean gets credit for the stop. First catch of the day for the Razorback tight end entering his sophomore year.
And, boy, we really got to have Hunter Henry have a big season. You talk about a freshman tight end that's got the ability to be a mismatch for defensive linebackers. Last year, he made some spectacular catches. It was good to really get him involved.
Alex Collins worked in at tailback now on third down and 4. Quick pitch on the right side. Collins gets the first down yardage. Deontay Carr on the stop.
And what you love about that particular play, it's a misdirection play that gives you an opportunity to get the pitch and get the ball to Alex on the corner. The one thing you like about his running ability, he doesn't dance. And when he has an opportunity to get that pitch, he knows when there's no more running room, he's going to lower his head and really try to get as many yards as he possibly can.
That was just the second time today that he's carried the football. He's in there now on first down and 10 at the white 32. Allen to throw, looking left side, and he connects. He's got his tight end, Cody Hollister. And another red first down.
Coach Chaney is saying, hey, you're going to play soft in the secondary. We're going to go ahead and take what the defense is giving us. The cornerbacks are really playing off, giving that 5-yard hitch route to the receivers. Coach Chaney is saying, hey, we need to do some things to get our passing game going. That's open, so that's what we're going to take.
I call Cody a tight end. He's a wide receiver, but he's a big guy. 6'4", 205. He's one of those newcomers, a junior college transfer from Oregon that could make a big impact in the passing game. First down and 10 now as the Hawks red squad has entered the red zone. Allen to throw. He's got Hatcher wide open over the middle, and Keon Hatcher gets inside the five. That's going to be very close to another first down. DeAndre Coley on the stop for the White.
Great play call by Coach Chaney right there, giving Brandon Allen an opportunity to complete a short pass. That's a zone beater. He started at the bottom of the formation, came all the way across, and then Brandon found him right between the safety and the linebacker. Great protection right there. You're talking about an offensive line last year that only gave up 8 sacks last year.
Yeah.
That's one sack every 37 passing attempts. Hopefully they can repeat that next year.
You got to have protection to run that route, don't you?
Absolutely.
Takes a little time to develop. Allen has a man out of the flat. It's caught by Ahrens, and it's a touchdown for the Red. Well, hands down, Quinn, the best drive of the day for the Red offense.
And that's what you love. This play right here is a play that's always open. There's no doubt about it. When you've got a great running game and that fullback is leading blocking, a lot of times they're going to forget about that fullback on the goal line. Brandon did a great job with the play action fake, got the ball out to the flat, and then he took what the defense gave him. He didn't look for anything else. And as most people say, you can't go broke taking a profit. And he got a touchdown on that play.
Brandon Allen, 4 out of 6 passing the football for 39 yards on that drive. And the Red opens it up 41-22. Let's head down to the sidelines and Mike Neighbors with a special guest. Mike.
All right, guys. I go from the gymnast to the center on last year's team. I'm suddenly shrinking. Everyone joins us. A lot of familiar faces from last year. Let's just talk about being back. Does it seem like a long time ago, or did it go by fast?
You know, this whole thing went by pretty quick. It's a little different being back and not being on the field, so you got to adjust to that. But, you know, this whole process has been great.
Talk about the offensive line. It's been a message this spring to play more physical, to step things up, to a little more experience. How do you evaluate this offensive line and what they've done the past couple months?
I think they've done a great job. You know, I've been out to a bunch of the practices and just seen how they've, you know, grown chemistry-wise, and, you know, they work on their technique and do everything. And I think they've taken a step in the right direction.
What areas do you think will be better than last year? Obviously, they're going to miss you and your leadership, but how can they play better than last year?
Well, I think the whole experience thing is going to help them out. You know, you can't really categorize that in anything itself. When you get another year under your belt, it just does wonders for you.
I talked to Zach Hucker about this earlier. Coach Bielma, you were here for his first season, and he told me it's night and day compared to last year. What gives you the faith that he can turn all this around?
Oh, just the coach that he is and the staff that he was able to bring in when he first got here. You know, I think it's the greatest coaching staff in all of college football.
We talked about going through the NFL draft process, all the interviews, the combine, the interviews, more interviews. We carry the New Orleans Saints on CST. They could use a center. That'd be a nice place to end up with Drew Brees, I guess, huh?
Yeah, that would be a great place. But, you know, I'm open to all 32 teams at this point.
How has this process been for you, the whole leading up to the draft?
It's been great. You know, it's some people you hear from, they say it's hectic and it's, you know, stressful, which at times it is. But I've tried to embrace it and have had, you know, a lot of fun with it.
All right, well, listen, good luck in the draft. I appreciate you taking the time.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, guys, offensive line may take some steps forward, but they'll miss the leadership of Travis Swanson next season. Back to you guys.
No question about it, Mike. Thanks very much. In fact, they're not sure who is going to replace Travis Swanson at this point, Quinn. There are a lot of guys who have already been shuffled in and may still be shuffled in. As the Red team gets an interception off a deflection, Carroll Washington picks it off. But they've had Mitch Smothers in there. They've had Luke Charpentier in there. They may put some other guys in there. In fact, Brett Bielema, in my talk with him earlier this week, maybe upwards of 5 guys they try out at Travis Swanson's position. And that's a little frightening going into the fall.
Yeah, you've got to find the right guy. A lot of people will take that center quarterback exchange for granted, but that's something that you really got to work on. But when you talk about Travis Swanson, you talk about a guy that is a leader. You talk about a guy that's the quarterback of the offensive line. He's a guy that helps Brandon really make all the checks. And so when you talk about setting protection, sliding protection one way, sliding protection the other way, fanning out, he's the guy that's really helping the offensive line see that. And so you got to have somebody that can really help with that leadership.
And how much, too, Quinn, is it more than just blocking? And how you were a quarterback. I mean, is that center quarterback exchange, as Brandon goes long for Hunter Henry and overshot him by just a step or two, people take that for granted when they watch football, but that's something that takes development, doesn't it?
Absolutely, especially when you've got a center as athletic as Travis Swanson. He's a guy that can snap the football and pull. Not very often do you have centers that can snap the ball and pull. So when you've got a situation, and in this offense, that center is required to do a lot of things. Like we talked about, they're the quarterback of that offensive line, but then they've got to be athletic and do some things. So when they're pulling and doing a lot of different things, you got to be able to stay in there as a quarterback and understand and have a good feel for what's happening with your center.
There's Smothers snapping the football as he's done today in the red-white game on second down and 10. Allen on the rollout, and a nice quick throw there, complete to Cody Hollister right at the sticks, and that should move them. They will. First down for the Red.
You know, Brandon is really starting to pick it up a little bit. Coach Chaney is, like I said, is taking advantage of the defense right now. So they're throwing a lot of quick outs, throwing a lot of quick hooks, giving Brandon some easy throws. He's making those throws. Those wide receivers are catching the football, and that's what you really want to see, catching the football, getting yardage, and not having drops.
Off the play fake, Allen has a man open. It's Hatcher, and Hatcher's got another first down, and he gets inside the 10-yard line. It's red zone time for the Red.
And that play is so effective, Scott. And the reason that's so effective, you got the play action quick fake on the trap, and then you've got an opportunity for Brandon to reset his feet. And then when you got a big receiver like Keon Hatcher, he has the ability to get that inside leverage. Brandon put that ball right where it needed to be, right in stride. Then Keon is a guy who can catch the football and actually run with the football. He's a hard guy to bring down after the catch. Need big catches from him this year.
Double tight end set here on first down and goal from the 8-yard line. Handoff goes to Corliss Marshall. A nice move in the backfield, and Marshall will score the touchdown for the Red. 2nd touchdown of the day for the Razorback running back.
And what you love about Corliss Marshall, you see he's starting to run between tackles. He had an opportunity to bounce that outside and really utilize his speed, so you like his thought process of seeing, hey, the goal line is closer to me if I go north and south. He made a move outside, dipped back in, and then showed some real physical running at the end. He's a collision guy. Also, he's a speed guy, so that explosiveness really helped him.
Yeah, and he tells me he's just a straight-ahead runner and wants to run full speed, but he had some nifty cuts on that run.
You know, he does a great job with his feet. And the thing about him, he's always moving forward, and he's always moving forward fast. And for a defender, when you see a guy with that type of explosiveness coming at you, well, you really got to make a decision, a career decision, if you want to jump in there and really make a tackle.
Brandon Allen, in the third quarter, 6 out of 9 passing for 76 yards. So a much better second half that will please Coach Bielema much more than that first half did. Well, watch the Razorbacks baseball team on Cox Sports Television Saturday, May 10th, when they host the Texas A&M Aggies live from Baum Stadium. First pitch is set for 7, 6 Central. For the full broadcast schedule, log on to coxsportstv.com. Rafe Peavy will be the signal caller on this series for the White as we get down to the late going in the third quarter of this red-white game. Peavy trying to get rid of it and finally does. A sidearm throw connects with Chris Jones, and Jones goes down the sideline for a big gainer. I think he stepped out of bounds, though, back near the first down marker, and he did. They're going to mark him out at the 36. It will be enough for the first down, but that was a little playmaking ability by Rafe Peavy there, making something happen out of nothing.
And that's what you want to be able to see. You got to have a quarterback that has the ability to get away from the rush and keep a play alive. Rafe did a great job of extending the play. The linebacker got lost in coverage, which gave the fullback an opportunity to get behind and get big yardage.
Cody Walker is the tailback on first down and 10. Peavy fakes to him. Cody's blocking the throw up and incomplete. Intended for Alex Bolsky again. There have been a lot of turnovers in the first half of this red-white game, making for excitement, but a headache for Brett Bielema.
A lot of turnovers are happening. You got to give a lot of credit to that defensive line and the defensive coaching staff. They've done a great job of adding pressure. The secondary has been in the right position all the time. And that's what you like to see. When you create turnovers, man, you really help your team out if you can turn them into touchdowns. They've done that today, but they've been all over, really forcing balls, really playing great coverage, really separating receivers from the football. So nice job by the defense today.
Man, I say a headache. I guess it depends on how you look at it. Your number one defense is creating it, so he's got to be happy with that. But if he's worried about his backup quarterback, he doesn't like that throw. There's kind of a good-bad scenario on every play.
It's hard to cheer
in a red-white game.
The band is going to be playing for somebody, you know, today. You really got to look for those coaching points.
I guess you want your ones ready for the fall, and you defer to them, and they certainly look good in that first half, especially up front with those guys. 2 defensive touchdowns on back-to-back plays in that first half. So another third and long for that white team. They've been used to this today. Rafe Peavy has not been set up for success against this defense.
He'll
try to make something happen again and overshoots his intended receiver, Drew Morgan. That'll bring up a white punt again. Well, so much for the continuous clock, Quinn. We are seeing stoppages after every incomplete pass. So we're down to 142 left to go in the third quarter.
Looks like Coach Bielema wants to keep that same format for a while to get those ones continuing to play together and trying to get some continuity. This is a great opportunity, though. I like the format. I like how they have the ones on the same team. Gives you an opportunity to get that game time experience. You know, when you have a turnover, the defense has an opportunity to go back on the field. And likewise with the offense.
A little mixture of red and white players on the special teams, and Cornelius calls for the fair catch at the 23-yard line. This copyrighted telecast of Arkansas football may not be retransmitted, reproduced, rebroadcast, or otherwise distributed or used in any form without the express written consent of Cox Sports Television. Our thanks to them for having us in the broadcast booth today. First chance for Quinn and I. We're together every Saturday in the fall, but we're usually on the radio for 3 hours talking about what might happen. It's nice to be up here and watch it as it unfolds.
Absolutely. This has been extremely fun, being able to talk about it and bring it to the fans. And, you know, it's a great day out here, great day with Razor Fest. A lot of things going on the Hill this week. And, you know, I got a chance to see some of the former players come back and, you know, so it's just a great experience in what they're doing today with things on the Hill.
And you were signing autographs a little bit before the game today.
Yeah, I was signing autographs and spending a little time. I was sitting right between Ryan Mallard and Zach Hawker, two legends. And, you know, all the kids and ladies wanted to take pictures with those guys.
All right, we have stopped play briefly here. There's a bit of a special moment going on. Brett Bielema bringing in a special player. He told us there were going to be special guests. Mike Neighbors is on the sidelines. Mike, what can you tell us?
We've been waiting for this all day, guys. How about 31-year-old Kanan Sandy is going to be the special guest. Check out, he's going to be involved in the game plan here. We didn't know what Brett Bielema had up his sleeve, but Kanan Sandy is your guy from Cave City, Arkansas. 31 years old. How about that run, guys? I don't think he's going to be touched. He's a Hogs fan since he was 2 months old. That's when he attended his first game. His mother, Ginger, entered him in an ESPN contest for the 2013 ESPN Hall of Fame. Guys, he received over 100,000 votes. Back to you.
What an awesome moment for him. And he takes it to the house. He will remember that forever.
Best run of the day. There's no doubt he did a great job of following his blocking. And, you know, Dan Skipper and Denver Kirkland were out there. And just, boy, I tell you, that's just a special moment to be able to get a touchdown in Razorback Stadium in front of all these great fans. He is extremely excited. Look at him. He's working the crowd, blowing kisses. He's doing a lot of great things.
Untouched for the touchdown run. We were told about those special guests. Coach Bielema would not tip his hand, but we get the surprise now. Mike, back to you.
Well, Ginger told me that he didn't find out till halftime either. He knew it was going to be something good today, but I think this exceeded all of his expectations. Pretty good stuff. Back to you.
He's not ready to leave the field yet. I think he's ready for another carry, Quinn.
That is awesome. He's flexing his guns. I love how he's flexing the guns. He's got the John Gruden face. He's showing the John Gruden look. Oh, that's awesome. He's working the crowd.
Step away. Come on.
Little added excitement to the red-white game here in Fayetteville.
Now, do those yards count for stats?
I'm gonna be interested to see when we get our next stat page if he shows up on there. That would make it even better, you know, because that goes in. It's written down forever.
That's right.
They'll be talking about him 20 years from now, whoever's doing the red-white game. You remember that long run by great running back number one? All right, so back to work now. The red team takes over at the 50-yard line. It's Collins in the backfield with Brandon Allen. Allen throws it complete to Jared Cornelius, and he gets to the first down, sticks at an eye for that. Rolled out of bounds at the 40-yard line by T.Q. Coleman, and it's a first down for the Red.
Now, that's a great ball by Brandon. That was on time, he in rhythm. He did a great job of really getting that ball out there. And the one thing that you like in those situations, when you fire that ball out into the flat, you got to give your receiver an opportunity to run and turn upfield and be able to make yardage. That's what he's doing. The yak yards are really critical in this offense.
Collins again, the tailback. Kendrick Payne split wide to the left, and it's a draw play to Collins. Ooh, and he is hit hard right at the line of scrimmage by T.K. Coleman. Coleman's had a big scrimmage. He's done a nice job, and he stopped Alex Collins in his tracks right there.
Well, they say he's a guy that's going to be able to contribute this year. There's no doubt about it. He's a guy that's moved from safety and played the linebacker position. He's a guy that you just really kind of got to get on the field, and he doesn't mind running in there. Every defense has got to have one of those crazy guys, you know, like Tony Bull and those kind of guys that'll just run in there and make something happen. He's the kind of guy that can do that. You got to be able to blitz and get to that quarterback, and he's a guy who can really get there.
This will likely be the final play of the third period. And Brandon Allen's going to throw. After the pump fake, he's looking back right now. He's going to run it. He'll be blown dead after maybe a yard. Dante Carr had him in his sights, and that's the end of the third quarter. So still 12 minutes left to go in the red-white scrimmage. Brandon Allen, Brett Bielema, Jim Chaney all feeling much better about themselves after the third quarter than they probably did at halftime. A successful run for the Red in period number three. As expected, although it didn't start off that way in the first half, tonight at 11:10 Central, watch CST Tonight live from the Louisiana Cat Studio. Co-hosts Victor Howell and Paul Crane break down the games of the week with highlights and analysis, and don't miss features from our reporters that you can't get anywhere else. CST Tonight, only on Cox Sports Television, your leader in Gulf South sports. Red team with the ball on a third down and long play here to start the fourth quarter. Good protection for Brandon Allen. Scrambling now, and he'll run for positive yardage, but not near what he needed to get the first down. So it'll be interesting to see now what Coach Bielema does on a fourth down play. Certainly in a game, in a real game situation, it would be a spot where you'd really think about going for it.
Yeah, absolutely. And you want to give your team a lot of opportunities to really try to make some plays happen. You know, we talked about the passing game, and the passing game has been pretty good when Brandon's under center. Where it's been a little bit spotty is when we've gone to shotgun and really tried to open it up a little bit. So I'm sure that's something that Coach Chaney's really going to try to work on. But you're right. This is a great opportunity to see, when we talk about this kicking battle,
yeah,
who has the opportunity to do something in front of fans.
Well, we're going
to
bring John Henson out to try a 52-yarder. Zach Hocker, you'd be pretty confident with. Let's see about Henson. And he had plenty of distance, but it was wide left. Wow, he had a lot of leg in that one, that's for sure. Let's go down to the sidelines once again, and Mike Neighbors, who's with Trey Flowers. Mike.
Thanks a lot, guys. You know, the Arkansas defense, the red side, has had their moments today, and that's without Trey Flowers, of course, the incumbent leader of this defensive line. Be honest with me. You're not playing. You knew you were playing. You're still wearing the pads. You wanted to be out there, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, most definitely. You know, it's hard for a football player to, you know, sit out and see that team compete and not being able to compete. But, you know, I understand all the things that come with it. I understand the reason behind it, just to, you know, get those young guys to get a few more extra reps. So,
talk about your reason to stay another year with this program. What was the main reason? What stood out for you?
Just knowing how this program is so close to turning around. You know, we had a couple bad games last season, but, you know, we learned from those games, and I saw towards the end of the year that, you know, what this team is really about. So, you know, just being able to be here for the turnaround, you know, was one of the main reasons.
Brand new defensive coordinator and Rob Smith, what is different about him? How has he put his imprint on this defense this spring?
He brings attitude. He brings a championship mindset. So, you know, the things we say before are defensive meeting is, you know, smart swarm, tackling, ball disruption. So them the three principles that he rely on as a defense. You know, he's preaching it every day that, you know, you gotta have an attitude of a championship or display a champion.
All You're on one side. Chris Smith was on the other side last year. He's on to the NFL, trying to find a replacement for him. Dietrich has looked really good out there today. Seems like there's some young guys that are going to step up.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. You know, like you said, Dietrich Wise, we got Brandon Lewis. He was a little nicked up this spring, but, you know, he's coming along very well. You got Jamichael Winston and, you know, the young guy, Tevin Beanham. So, you know, I'm excited to see these guys. They out here and they're learning. That's a more important thing.
Listen, I appreciate your time. I know it's been hard today, but enjoy the rest of the game and great luck next season.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
All right, Trey Flowers will be a big, big part of this Arkansas defense, guys. Back to you.
Absolutely, Mike. Thanks very much. Led the team in tackles for loss with 13 and a half, and he had 5 sacks. Worked well in that tandem with Chris Smith, but now he's going to be the guy when those offenses game plan. That's the guy they're going to try to take out of the game.
And with good reason. And that's why it's so important to get some of those other guys to step up and get that interior pressure as well. We've seen a lot of guys step up, but you can almost say getting Trey Flowers back was the biggest recruit that we got this year. He had to go back and recruit him and keep him from going to the pros. So now it's a great opportunity for him to really come in and do a great job. He is a guy that rushes with a ferocious ferocity, and he does it with great pad level and speed.
And he obviously, as we've seen today, will likely get some good help from Dietrich Wise on the other end. We're back with more from Fayetteville after this. Left to go in the 2014 red-white game. See a few of the white team offensive linemen taking a breather as the defense for the white squad back out onto the field. Brandon Allen back to work. He had a good third quarter. He hits Cornelius on the first play back from the break. Oh, we're actually told now Austin Allen is taking over for the red team, so he has switched over now. Yep, I recognize the sleeves now. So Austin Allen will get a chance to run with the ones here in the final 7 minutes. He's got Corliss Marshall in the backfield with him. Second down and 4. To the ground with Corliss Marshall. Marshall has the first down, and that's going to be about it. He's rolled down by DeAndre Coley. And also Jamichael Winston in there as well.
Corliss runs with just explosiveness. He's a guy that just runs through tackles. You can't arm tackle him. If you're going to come to the party really trying to tackle him, you better bring a sack lunch to get him down.
What are you watching for here, Quinn, from Austin Allen getting a chance to run with the number ones?
Well, I think that's really a good situation from Allen, for Austin Allen to be in that situation, to have that offensive line, to do some great protection. I think what you're just looking for is for him to be steady, move the team down the field. The offense will tell you if the quarterback is doing their job by moving down the field. And Austin is, you know, you just want to sit in there, make sure you're going through your reads, going through your progression, stay calm, not try to do anything, you know, outside the realm of the offense, go through your progressions. And I think that's really what Coach Chaney is wanting to see from Austin in this particular situation.
Coach Bielema said the position he's most concerned about heading into the fall is backup quarterback. Not sure who his number two is going to be. Neither one has been in game time situations. And that's Jonathan Williams on the carry for maybe a half yard at best. So this is some very valuable time for Austin Allen. And one of the things, too, moving two guys over from quarterback in Duwop Mitchell and in A.J. Derby gave Austin and Rafe Peavy a chance to have a lot more reps in the spring.
Yeah, and when you're talking about developing as a quarterback, you can't do it from watching. And if you got 5 quarterbacks in the rotation, you're not getting as many reps as you need to. Plus, those other two guys are really going to contribute in other areas. So they made the decision and said, hey, we're going to go with these three as our quarterback. And it's great that they're getting those reps. And it's good to see Austin in this particular situation.
Draw play on 3rd and 5. And Jonathan Williams has got the first down. Nice little hesitation step. And he will get down to the 41-yard line of the Whites. Brought down by Nicholas Thomas Smith.
One guy afterwards. I didn't know.
Certainly, Jonathan Williams has looked in mid-season form today for sure.
Well, Jonathan has done a great job today. He's a physical guy. He's running with great vision and purpose and does a nice job really running between the tackles.
Here's Collins, who's hit and keeps those legs churning. He does that better than anybody, and he gets down inside the 35-yard line. That's about an 8-yard gain.
Well, and that's the thing with this offense is you've got to deal with three physical running backs, and they're going to continue to come at you. If you take a play off on defense, these guys got an opportunity to really hurt you. So that's why you want to stay in front of the sticks, be able to move the football, run in the football, be able to run, rotate fresh backs in there. It just really gives you an opportunity to be successful and get to the goal of 200 yards rushing and 200 yards passing.
Razorbacks over 208 on average last year. This time Allen's going to throw, and he lofts one up to the end zone. Nicely thrown and connects for the touchdown to Cody Hollister. 33-yard bomb from Austin Allen to Cody Hollister. That was a well-thrown ball.
A well-thrown ball and a great move by Cody Hollister. You know, Austin did a great job with the shoulder fake, but Cody Hollister did a great job with the double move. He gave him the old okey-doke. He stopped and started, got behind the defensive back. Austin threw a great ball back there, giving his receiver a great opportunity. And you can see the hands that they've talked about all spring, Cody being one of those guys that has a great opportunity to really help us out this year.
That was Kevin Richardson in coverage, a redshirt freshman. And the extra point is booted through, making it a 61-22 count for the red over the whites. Well, you talk about Austin Allen getting some valuable time in this game, even though it's short-lived as the clock now rolls closer to 2.5 minutes. But he may have to step in. You don't want Brandon Allen to be hurt. And they've talked a lot about this spring, getting Brandon bigger and stronger and being able to take that physical punishment in the SEC. And when you look at that 2014 schedule, he's going to take some punishment. There are some really good teams on that schedule.
Well, there are some big dogs on that schedule, and probably one of the toughest schedules in America when you talk about starting off with Auburn. You got to go to the Plains and really get it going against Gus Malzahn and his squad. But you know that SEC schedule is always going to be extremely tough. And then you add Georgia onto the schedule, and that really doesn't help out anything. So everybody that we're playing against are really up and coming. And you got a few teams on that schedule that are going to be looking to replace some quarterbacks. But yeah, at the end of the day, well, I tell you, that schedule is extremely tough. And you really got to come in with a mindset of being physical. And that's what this staff is really talking about offensively and defensively, being more and more physical and really trying to compete each and every week.
Boy, and that really puts it back on the defensive line for me, too. If you've got some new quarterbacks, especially the ones we're going to see early in the season, you really got to harass them, don't you? Because even good quarterbacks are bad when they're under pressure.
Well, and that's the thing about it. I feel very good about the defensive line and what they're doing. You know, Coach Segrist is doing a great job of really getting those guys playing. You like the coverage aspect of it, of what's going on. The defense is really going to have to help us out this year. I mean, you know, last year they were put in some situations. They gave up 30 points a game, so they really want to improve on that. And so I think that we're in a situation right now where the defense has got to be able to create havoc. And when they get a quarterback that is pretty new, fairly new, they really got to cause problems and concerns for that guy.
Inside of a minute to go in the red-white game. I don't know what Brett Bielema told him at halftime, but it worked. They've looked much sharper here in the second half than the first. Damon Mitchell working out of the tailback spot, and he is going to be hit in the backfield. Didn't get anything going there. So Mitchell, coming into spring camp, was a quarterback, moved to wide receiver. Now he had an opportunity there to run it out of the tailback spot.
He's a versatile guy, there's no doubt. When you come in as a quarterback, you start playing receiver, then you play running back, you've got an opportunity to be on the field. Keep in mind, he's a wild card. You can always come up and devise some play where he can throw the football out of any situation. So anytime he's on the field, you got to know where he's lined up at and really pay homage to him.
All right, they may get one snap off. Under 5 seconds left in the game. They're going to have to hurry. Well, they've got it stopped on 7, actually, up on the game clock. Our scoreboard clock there on our graphic was a little bit ahead of the game clock, and now it goes to zero. So they did get the snap off. It ends with an incomplete pass. 61-22, the final, the red over the white. You know, the thing I noticed, too, is they skipped at the end of the third quarter the field goal kicking contest. I get the feeling that Coach Bielema kind of adjusted the spring game rules on the fly after that first half.
And when you're the head hog, you can do that.
That's
you say,
right.
Hey, I got people here. I got a great situation where I'm going to test some of my young kids and really put them in a situation where they have to perform in front of fans. And so he took the liberty of saying, hey, we're going to continue the format and really give these guys a great opportunity to continue to play. I think it's a great thing, especially when you talk about having three new defensive coaches. It's a great opportunity to continue to work on that defense, get the communication down in a game-like situation.
He may have worked them a little harder and a little longer than they anticipated when they put the shoulder pads on today, but Coach Bielema got what he wanted in the second half, I'm pretty sure. Let's go down to the sidelines and Mike Neighbors. Mike.
Big day for the red offense, guys. You have quarterback Brandon Allen and running back Corliss Marshall. Corliss, we'll get to you in just 1 second. Let's talk about this game. Kind of a slow start, but you heated up.
Yeah, first half really wasn't what we wanted. Just not clicking offensively. Not everyone had their minds in the game. And you know, we were able to come back in the second half and kind of put on what we were proud of.
Talk about this spring for you. You took a big step forward. You had some competition. Coach Bielema told me this week, though, you haven't budged and you've kind of broken away from the pack. That has to feel good.
Yeah, you know, the competition always brings out the best in everyone. So I think the competition we have at quarterback is bringing the best in me and the best in everyone else to practice. So that's only going to make our team better. And, you know, we did a good job of that.
All right, nice game.
Thank you.
Quarterback Brandon Allen. Here's the running back, DeJour. I mean, you guys have Collins. You have Jonathan Williams. Here's Corliss Marshall. No doubt you seem to have the best backfield in the SEC.
Yeah, man. I'm really just known for the guy that, you know, gives us the spark, you know, hypes everybody up over a good play. And, you know, I'm just playing my role. You know, I'm learning from the two running backs that are ahead of me. And, you know, it doesn't matter to me that I only get a couple touches from here to there. You know, I'm just learning, still in the learning process. Hopefully we can continue to move forward.
Coach Bielema has lit up when asked about your runs this spring. Mm-hmm. I know as a power runner, that's something you take a lot of pride in.
Yes, sir. I actually do take a lot of pride in it. And, you know, I've been switching up my game. You know, I've been more of the tossish, sweepish kind of guy. They're utilizing me more in the A gaps. And, you know, I feel more comfortable running inside, getting my vision better. I'm just getting all the qualities down of being the perfect running back.
Corliss, how good can this offense be if the young receivers step up, Brandon Allen takes a step forward, and you already have the running game intact?
Man, this offense could be unstoppable. Yeah, we got a couple bumps and bruises here to there, but I'm sure those will get fixed. And, you know, as we go through this summer program and fall camp, I honestly think we're going to be a great team this year.
All right, listen, great game today, great spring. Appreciate you taking the time.
Yes, sir, anytime.
All right, part of the three-headed monster in this Hogs backfield, Corliss Marshall, Alex Collins, Jonathan Williams. Take your pick, guys. Back up to you.
I wouldn't want to if I was an opposing defense. There's no question about that. Mike Neighbors, great job on the sidelines today for us in the red-white game. We will take a break and come back and wrap things up in Fayetteville in just a moment. Here from Donald W. Reynolds, Razorback Stadium. You see the final score from Arkansas's red-white game today. The red with a big win over the white. That part was expected, but as we welcome you back inside the booth, what was not expected was a slow, sluggish start from the red offense. And you heard Brandon Allen say some guys didn't have their minds in the game. And we saw Coach Brett Bielema take them to task for that at halftime, but a much sharper game in the second half.
Much sharper game in the second half. And you can see Brandon really, really settling down and really getting the offense going. I think Coach Chaney did a great job of calling plays that really put him in a great position to complete some passes. And when you talk about being a quarterback, you want to be able to have confidence. So once you got completions of passes and then you got that running game working the way it needs to, boy, you got a great opportunity to have success.
One of the things you want to see from the red, I mean, since it was a ones against the world format, was some eye-popping stats. And for me, the eye-popping stats were Corliss Marshall, 95 yards on just 5 carries, including a couple of touchdown scores. And then on the other side of the ball for the red front, 8 sacks for the red defensive front. Those were the standouts for me.
Well, you love to be able to see the three-headed monster really come to life from a running back standpoint. Corliss Marshall is a home run hitter, and those two backs, Jonathan Williams and Alex Collins, those are guys who really have done it in the SEC level, averaging 5.3 yards a carry in a tough SEC season. Then you get a home run hitter like Corliss Marshall. Boy, it's a great opportunity to really have that three-headed monster. But then you got to give a lot of credit to the defense. The coaching staff has done a great job with the defensive front. The secondary did a good job in coverage, and they made plays when they had opportunities. So give the defense a lot of credit, a lot of good things to really go back from a coaching standpoint.
Yeah, a lot of things to work on as they go into fall camp as well into August. But your thoughts as a as a generalized look at this spring game, with no more looks, no more practices until August, you got to chew on this for a few months. Yeah. How do you feel about the team?
Well, I feel good. Again, the defensive front really showed up today, so I feel really good about the defense and what they're doing. They seem to have that communication down, and that's really making a difference in what's going on and how they're playing out there. You know, you continue wanting to see a little bit more from the offense in the passing game, especially when we went shotgun in three and four wides. I think that that's something that they're going to have to continue to work on and really get in a groove. But I think it's going to take Brandon Allen really working with those receivers in the offseason, making plays and really getting to know each other so we can be successful.
Hey, the next time you and I are together, we'll be down on the plains.
Wow. Can't wait for it. It's going to be great.
Tough start for the Razorbacks. A tough draw for the season opener against the national championship runner-up in the Auburn Tigers. Well, that's going to do it for our broadcast. We're so glad that you came and watched today the red-white game. Again, that slow start, but the highlights, they came in bunches beginning about halfway through the second half. We had a little bit of everything. Defensive touchdowns, offensive strikes, and long runs. We thank you for joining us. Don't forget to watch the Razorback baseball team on CST Saturday, May 10th, when they host Texas A&M. For Quinn Grovey and Mike Neighbors, I'm Scott Inman. The final score, Red 61, White 22. This has been a production of CST.